you free. Nobody you meet could ever see the loneliness there.
Inside you,
hey there, Georgie girl. Why do all the boys just pass you by? Could it be you just don't try?
Oh no! Someone horribly square from outside London. Let's hurry past and find some fab, groovy chicks.
Have a few wild parties, and then you can get pregnant.
Pregnant? But I'm still a virgin.
You've been in swinging London for 24 hours, and you're still a virgin. You're just not trying.
I am trying, really I am. I really want to be fab and swinging, really I do.
Well, if you're still a virgin tomorrow, it'll just be too square to be in my pad. Anyway, we've been talking for 2 minutes. It's time to have a wild party.
And in your pad.
I'm going back to the suburbs to have the baby. back to Mum and Dad.
But you can't. You've got to end up wandering the streets with no friends, pushing a pram and being punished for being immoral, like a really groovy 60s person should. I've done it. The guys have done it.
Yeah, that groovy coming to a bad end is right up to the exact nowadays 1960s minute. Tick tock.
You'll get home and your parents will find out you're pregnant and they'll tell you never to darken their doors again and you'll end up on the streets, lonely but fab and groovy.
But my parents understand.
Oh no, how square.
And they'll love me and look after me and we'll live happily ever after. Oh, all right. I'll be fab and groovy.
Yeah.
Isn't this fab?
Yeah, groovy, really 60s.
Good evening. My name, as you probably all know, is Erica Perfect, and I will be giving this evening's class in the series Great Mistresses of the Theatre. Firstly, I'd like to introduce you to my four victims. They are, from left to right, Susan Harris, who was widely acclaimed for her recent brilliant portrayal of Rosalind in As You Like It, apparently. Then Stuart Hearn and Louise Ambrose, who you wouldn't have seen in anything unless you're under five or in prison. And last, but by no means least, the tall, dark, handsome John Rhodes, whom I predict will go very far in this difficult old business of ours. Right, to work. The first excerpt I have chosen is the famous interview scene in the play The Importance of Being Earnest, or, as we professionals know it, importance, or indeed, Ernest. Now, Susan and John, would you read, please?
Now to minor matters. Are your parents living?
I have lost my parents.
To lose one parent, Mr. Worthing, may be regarded as a
I'm sorry, can I interrupt? Carry on.
June, to lose both looks like carelessness.
Yes, but remember, this is high comedy. That is, well, it's comedy, but it's not actually very funny. Come on.
Who is your father?
I'm afraid I don't really know. Well, the fact is, Lady Bracknell, I said I had lost my parents. It would be nearer the truth to say my parents seem to have lost me. I don't actually know who I am by birth. I was found.
Found?
Comedy of manners, remember. Manners. If you spit like that, you must say, I beg your pardon, afterwards.
The late Mr. Thomas Cardew found me and gave me the name of Worthing because he happened to have a first-class ticket for Worthing in his pocket at the time.
Where did the charitable gentleman who had a first-class ticket for this seaside resort find you?
In a handbag.
A handbag?
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry, I've got to stop you there. A handbag? Why do you stress this word so?
Well, Edith Evans did it like that.
Who?
Edith Evans. She was famous as Lady Bracknell. She was a dame.
Well, there you are then. I'm pleased to say that I have never had to resort to appearing in pantomime. Good way to speak of that. It's got to be believable, love. Let's try a little exercise, shall we? And I'll show you what I mean. Now, Susan, this is the leather counter at Derry and Tom's, and you're coming to me to purchase a handbag, okay? Could I help you, madam?
Yes, I'd like a handbag.
A what?
A handbag.
There you are, you see? A handbag. You didn't say, a handbag. In fact, nothing would tempt you to say, a handbag, unless you were playing an inebriate or something. Fine if you want to be actressy and showy, lovey, but we're in the business of truth.
Would you mind if we continue with this exercise? I find it very useful. Oh. Right, so I'll try and sell you a handbag. What would you like, madam?
I'd like a handbag, please. How much is that?
£5,000, madam.
How much?
£5,000.
For a handbag?
There you are, then. Contest.
Well, I'm sorry, Lovey, but if you don't want to learn anything, maybe you shouldn't be here. This class is for people who want to learn something from an old hand.
Old has-been, you mean?
Don't look at your handbag! Well, how she managed to slip through the net. On to our next piece, I think. The Bard, William Shakespeare. We've got a lovely scene from Richard III. Now, Louise, I'd like you to read Lady Anne and John Richard. This is the scene where Richard, who is not yet the third but just a duke, tries to woo Lady Anne, who is attending her husband's funeral.
When can I have a go?
Excuse me?
When can I have a go?
I'm sorry, but I don't quite understand. Everyone knows that Jack Worthing and Richard III were not fat. They're not fat rules.
That's hardly fair.
Fair? Who said anything about it being fair? If there was any fairness in this business, it'd be me up there at the National playing all the main parts instead of Nergy Smith and Janet Sussman and all those other third-raters. Fair? Don't make me laugh. There's only one way to get on in this business nowadays. Change your name to Judy Dench. Yes. The third piece is from what we professionals call the Scottish play. This old theatrical superstition says that if you mention the word Macbeth, something always goes wrong. But I don't believe... Hello? Oh dear, we appear to have blown a fuse. Well, tell you what, in the meantime, I'll give you a few hints on radio acting. Oh, good. There we are. Now, well... Hello? Hello? Camera one? The art of the monologue.